right. I'm tethered. All right. Can we cut this? Thank you. Thank you. So this playlist you've been listening to is the Direct Support House Concerts playlist on Spotify. And I know Spotify is the devil, but it's very useful for things like this. So welcome, everyone. I'm Debbie. This is my house. That's Steve. It's also his house. Thank you. Thank you. So this is Direct Support House Concerts. This is our house concert series. We love doing these things, even though we are an absolute seething petri dish of infection in Austin right now. I'm going to try to keep these going as long as I can. Thank you for being safe. Thank you for your masks. I was going to do a fun little game of Simon Says to practice, like, you know, Simon Says, mask up. But I think y'all get it. I'm feeling like everybody just gets it. So that's my only thing. When you go in to use the restroom, please do put your mask on, keep it on, and then get your ass out of my house and come right back out here. Yeah, and we'll be good. Bathroom is inside. There's ample signage. We've tested it. Detroit helped me to test the signage. That is Ed's son, Detroit, for anybody who might not know. Bless you. Hamill is the
honestly,
shit.
Honestly, his mother was good looking.
His slogan is Hamill is the shit, and it applies to both of them. So we have two shits up here, and they're great. So normally I say this is a listening room, sound really carries, so, you know, please try to keep your voices down, but this is Ed Hamill. You're not going to get over his volume once he's playing, I'm sure. But nonetheless, for those of you in adjacent houses who are listening, please don't cut the grass right now. Thank you very much. I love you, neighbors.
You'll be evicted after my gig.
We own this bitch.
There we go.
So, no. What else do I want to say? Anybody, first time here? Awesome. Welcome. Welcome to our yard.
It'd be so cool if your husband raised his hand. It's like, you don't remember, motherfucker?
We're going to get you on the dementia meds next week, I promise. Anybody who is the first time seeing Ed? Ooh, all right. You are in for some foul language and a really awesome treat. Listen carefully to the lyrics. That is the thing that I love the most about Ed. And that's saying something because I love a lot about Ed. I also want to introduce you to our sound engineer.
In the name of love.
We'll hug later. Because this is direct
this
support.
This is the only shit that'll get on YouTube, right? This shit
yeah,
here.
Right. Yeah, all the outtakes. You get my absolute worst angle. Thanks, Woodstock. Thanks. Come on. Up. That's better. It's better. I lost 20 pounds as he stood up.
Let me make the sound of a helicopter so we can make sure we're getting drone shot.
Oh, my God. Okay. As the birds go over. So, okay. It's called direct support for this reason. The artist on a bill who plays right before the headliner is called the direct support act. Their job is to bring more draw, to get more attendance for the headliner so they can, you know, cross promote. What we are doing here, direct support, means we're putting money in the artist's pocket directly. So all the money that you paid for your tickets, it's going to him. You also paid your Eventbrite fee, so he wouldn't have to pay it. Thank you for that. $100 out of what y'all paid for your tickets just went to this man. This is Will Evans. He is our sound engineer.
And he spent it on crack?
Yeah, he's already...
See, you're all enablers. Fuck you.
He's already been down the street getting his hookup. No, it's... As we come back from the pandemic, it's going to be all the more important for us to support our independent artists directly and to support our engineers. They've also lost a lot of work through this. And especially those who had what's called a house gig where they were in a venue. Venue's closed. I mean, these guys are hurting for work too, and they can't very well live stream their show because, you know, they don't have a show. So thank you for supporting Will as well. You can do even more with the tip signs. I have the QR code for Ed to tip him. I have the QR code for Will to tip him. But let me draw your attention to the best merch setup that I've ever seen. I have 4 Ed Hamill pieces upstairs, and I have a feeling that there's going to be another one that's going to follow me home tonight. So please do buy the merch, tip the band, tip the engineer, and Ed is going to do one just like gonzo set all the way through. Just like one, can I say like balls out? I mean, don't do it literally, but like one like balls out set for an hour. So... I see he's thinking. Don't do it.
I'm not saying anything. I'm like completely caught off guard by this. Well, this is like,
you see what happens when you give a redhead a microphone. So he's going to do 1 hour all the way through. For those of you who have been to my shows before, you know we typically split it up, but I mean that's not an Ed Hamill show. So be prepared for that. Feel free to, you know, use the restroom in between if you need to. Feel free to go buy things from Detroit while the music is going.
This is really nice because I was just doing shows in the neighborhood, and a lot of the neighbors wouldn't have me, and you did, and you built this, and it's really, really nice. And I sell Amway now, so maybe I'm
good.
Fucking with
yeah.
you.
I mean, I just stack up the multi-level marketing endeavors, and we'll buy everything
you really
you do.
Got the shtick. Good for you.
All right, that's all I'm going to say. I'm going to introduce Ed right now, and then when we're done, I'm going to ask him some pointed questions about money. So stick around for that. Is everybody ready? Okay. Here's one thing that I do want to practice. Let's practice how loud can you be? Let's hear it. Okay, that'll do. Y'all are good. You're sufficient. You pass. You're competent. All right. You ready, Ed?
Yeah, thanks.
Let's do it.
Thank you, Deb.
Very Ed nice Hamill. Job.
I got it. Before I really get into it, because I got a new record that I've been working on. It's entitled Every Song Could End in Bloodshed, Bring the Kids. And it has little songs in between, like little... like D Boone, Minutemen, kind of. So I want to open up with a brand new song for you to give you an indication of what I'm up to these days. Heed your conscience. Heed your conscience. Heed your conscience. Mitch McConnell, kill yourself. All right, here we go. If you need a place to hide, well, you can come inside. You're safe here. If the wolf is at your door and you can't take no more, you're safe here. In a world that's crazy gone, if you think you can't go on, if your soul is about to suggest lots of hope of face neglect, if you need protection from, cause the world is crazy's come, if the water's at your nose and you're on your tippy toes, you're safe here. I said you're safe here. If they do not get the joke, your dreams are up in smoke, you're safe here. If the bank has lost its smile, heaven's burn your fire, you're safe here. If the house has seen a flood and the preacher's dumb as mud, if you got blood on your shoes, they've blacked out your baby blues. If the guns are manned and drawn, burning crosses on your lawn. If the sheriff's drunk as hell, just wait on their holding cell, you're safe here. Square peg in a round hole, it's gonna take its toll. I would have seen at the end of the bar, there in the back of the crack was our stranger thinking through the door. Checked up boots to the bit same floor, whistling knowing if it's better. Catchy tune, spoke at death, holds in his hands, hoodie of thorn, sides of the beard, I will want. Next to me, he took his seat, he said, hey, pilgrim, time we meet. What's your pleasure, what's your style? I ain't seen you for a while. 4 days later, I woke in the dirt, noose on my neck, blood on my shirt, didn't know it was. Had a moment of zen, sent up Joe to do it again. Cast a console, hall of shame, after midnight in the rain, a club of fools that cried despair. Ran him in the underwear and you're safe here. Crab peg in a round hole, it's gonna take your soul. If the doctor turns and cries, runs out of alibis, you're safe here. If the law says none shall pass, the devil's on your ass, you're safe here. You see the haters, instigators, all the verbal masturbators, all the trollers, BS rollers, all the workers, barely polar, the junkies and the flunkies and the buses and the monkeys, all the stalkers and the gawkers, the heinous horror talkers, you.
your safety. Trap hanging around home, it's gonna fuck your soul. Lawn party. Well, I'm broker than broken. It's all up in smoke. I got zero. Gambling beat, no shoes on my feet. I ain't no hero. My luck is awful, lost at a horrible cost, and I'm down, held to ground, and viewed as unsound. And I gotta say, I'm the happiest man in the world. When you ain't got nothing, they ain't got nothing they can take away. I got all the time in the world. Check out this gorgeous day. Ain't got no cell phone. Bill collectors leave me alone. I ain't got no unaffordable mortgage on no unaffordable home. And I gotta say, I'm the happiest man in the world. Well, look at my friends. They're all like jewels. I'm rich. Some people get power and they act like fools. I never switch. Sitting on a park bench loving the sun. I ain't got a nickel, but it sure is fun. And I gotta say, I'm the happiest man in the world. I went to the ATM when I woke and almost choked when it spoke, said, you are broke, financially depleted. Your money is deleted, like your hairline, it has receded. It continued to speak and said, it's bleak, your troubles are peak, but it offered a solution, a bit of restitution. This ATM was a machine with the means spilling the beans to pay for my dreams. I said, oh, you're giving me chills. Spit out the bills. I need a tower of gold, the contents of a king's billfold. I need the treasure in a pirate's hold. I need cash, hot and cold. I'm insatiable from what I've been told. I need the profits of a corporation stolen. If I could be so bold, with Wall Street stolen enough door to buy rolls and hand-tailored clothes and mansions and islands that I've chosen. I don't want to die. I want my body to be froze. Security that'll never doze. Life sculpture to perpetual pose. I want the ability to buy and sell men's souls. I want to be bathed in velvet from my head to my toes. I want my teeth capped in gold, so when the light goes out, my head it glows. Now, no sooner had I spoken than the ATM spit out a bus token. Said, here's the situation. You'll be taking public transportation. I was incredulous. This was an insult off the charts. I say, what do I look like? Cinderella of the Walmart? I felt like a clown as I drove through the town in the bus in the back. I thought I had riches, but I didn't have jack. I in the street, trying to comprehend my defeat. Who did I spy with my little eye? But Sheena with a new life complete. See, she had done time for a serious crime, but after incarceration, she had given her life a new interpretation by ringing the bell for the salvation of souls. And when they hear the bell toll, they know they're in receipt of a place to eat and a place to warm their feet. I said, look at my friend Sheena. Ain't she an angel? Righteously sweet. Her life could have been for naught. Her resurrection was hard fought. Here comes Bobby. He's off the pipe. He should have been dead, we all thought. He was up to his neck. He was a wreck, but he kept it in check with a sense of humor. He has laughing at his antics, even through tumor. Hope he hangs on to his health, because roaring at his glorious stories adds to my wealth. There's Jennifer. She's working, clerking. She's also on the pole. Got the young boys jerking. That's no judgment berserking. Homelessness is lurking. She's got a special needs child, so she does it all with a smile, bordering on smirking. You know, I think it's safe to say that I had an epiphany that day. Look at all my friends, barely employed, maintaining their integrity, not null and void, inspirational, conversational. These are the things that I've enjoyed. I've seen beggars with the stature of kings. I've seen homeless sharing as if they had wings, and other things like patience on death's door, smiling more, not knowing what's in store. I saw with clarity, charity, and a humble big lore, and I went back to that ATM again, and I requested an encore, because sometimes you gotta open up your eyes and see what life is truly for. And that ATM didn't gloat. Said, oh, you ain't really broke. You're rich as a king. You just ain't got no money. That's the thing. The more shit you got, the more shit you got, then I'll break. Put down that cell phone. Talk to me face to face. I'm checking out people. I'm loving their ways. And I ain't been broker in all of my days. And I gotta say, I'm the happiest man in the world. And I gotta say, I'm the happiest man in the world. And I gotta say, I'm the happiest man in the world. With the pandemic, I wasn't out much, so I didn't see a lot of people. So I apologize if you're anticipating jokes. If I used to tell some jokes on stage, but I don't have any new ones, and I apologize. If you Googled me, you never heard me, and you thought, well, so we'll give you like a dollar back on the way out or something.
No, we will not.
I got one joke. It's husband and wife getting ready to go out, and she says, tell me, do I look fat in this dress? He goes, you promise? You won't get mad no matter what I say. She said, I promise. He said, I fucked your sister. I'm available for weddings, too. Well, here. So I know a lot of you are thinking, where can I go in Pflugerville with a P and hear a polka on a Saturday afternoon? Well, right fucking here. This is three absolutely true drug-related incidents that happened to me. When you were young, you should have nothing more than fun. You should swim in every gutter. You should ravish every lover. You should torment every mother when you're young. When you are old, a thousand stories to be told. I'll learn how to flop right, running every stoplight, making every cop fight when you're young. Now, when I was 21, I had little time for fun. I was balancing the college and the band. Now, driving home one day, I saw along my way two hitchhikers I picked up in my van. Oh, it seemed so very silly, yet kept on saying chilly instead of saying cool. That was their word. Chilly vet, chilly this, chilly hit, chilly miss. It seemed the oddest thing I'd ever heard. Well, out came the cannabis, and let me tell you this. They rolled a joint big as a redwood tree. Redwood tree's a big fucking tree, people. A shotgun on the menu, barely got them to their venue. Lost in the cloud of smoke that consumed me. Oh, I was so high, I was chilly blind, almost lost my chilly mind. But I got them to the chilly place, they had the chilly steak. I said, thanks, boys, it was chilly. You nearly chilly killed me. I want you both to have a chilly, chilly day. When you were young, you should have nothing more than fun. Oh, you should dance until the dawn on the hotel lawn. All your clothes are gone when you're young. Now at 4 a.m. you lack that substance known as crack. You've been smoking for 3 days, you are blind. And you fall down on your knees, scan the carbon and say, please, just one more rock, I'll leave it all behind. Well, you know that it is gone, but then you stumble on a small rock. How could you have missed it? Your heart goes pitter pitter. You know it's kitty litter. You put it in your pipe. You can't resist it. We've all done it. I know my demographic. Don't be coy. God is pressing matters. The Middle East is in tatters. And storms have washed cities down the drain. But you've been good a year. Can he just see his way clear to turn that litter into rock cocaine? And as you bend the flame, you call the God by name. Lord God on high, have you got my back? Because in your fevered mind, he's turned water into wine. So can he just perform the miracle of the crack? When you are young, you should have nothing more than fun. Oh, never doubting you can fly. Never pause to wonder why. Never thinking you will die when you're young. Three, absolutely true, drug-related incidents that happened to me. Number three. I was trading toast on the Florida coast with a friend who told me quite the tale. Although the fish weren't biting, yet an unusual sighting on a fishing trip when he set sail. Something caught his eyes when there on the horizon a suspicious box floated curiously. So he glanced in each direction, and sensing no detection, he brought it home to open it and see. It was an amazing sight, all this powder just off-white. He dipped a knife in, took a little snort. But much to his dismay, no reaction came his way. His cocaine was a dud, I must report. But he kept on sifting through, and what I tell you is true. A crematorium medallion he did find. Absolutely true, absolutely fucking true. I am Velcro for weird shit, obviously. He let out a great cry, see, he had snorted the dead guy. And to this day, a ghost is wandering through his mind. When you are young, when you are young, when you are young, you should have nothing more than fun. Oh, never doubting you can find, never pause to wonder why, never thinking you will die when you're young.
Thanks. All true. The story before that, the happiest man, all those people, that's true. The one ringing the bell, her real name was... So I should tell you, for those of you that don't know, when I was 14 years old, a friend of mine got a hold of a bag of organic mescaline, about this big, which he had every intention of selling, but we didn't. We did it. And I tripped every day from the age of 14 to 18. So there's no linear thought pattern. It's a bit like impressionistic, depending on where you are. Like in the front, they're like, what? In the back, makes sense to us. It depends on where you are. So there's no, there's nothing planned, is the point. Anyway, so the woman, I was married, so my son's with me. I was married to his mom for 25 years. We're still good friends. We split up, it wasn't my idea, but we split up 10 years ago, and Detroit comes with me every summer. We tour. We've probably done a couple hundred thousand miles in the car together since he was six. He's going to come up, tell you some jokes, and we'll do a tune together a little later in the show. But anyway, so I hung around in a futile attempt, the house. I stopped touring Europe and just stayed on the East Coast mostly, and got a job actually managing at the library, managing a little cafe. And there was a woman there, the one ringing the bell, that worked for the Salvation Army. She was sober now, but she had been, she was sober for 7 years. Her real name was Kathy. And she had killed her, well, in a drunken blackout, killed her abusive boyfriend. And so she had to do 7 years in Sing Sing, which was where I live, not Sing Sing, Sing where we live. So she was a murderer. And I was single.
Hell yeah.
So she's fucking hot is the point I'm trying to make. We all have a bucket list, all right? Kate Moss, twins, a murderer, you know? So here's some signs about parenting. Joe Segway, motherfuckers. Get out the jarts. Let's go at it. Fuck it. Two signs about parenting. You got a kid, I got a kid. Are you gonna tell him the things you did? Tell him the truth about your sordid youth. Now if he wants to know, did you do blow? Did you get high and listen to the stereo? Now Pops, when's the first time you did a drug crime? I smoked my first J on my 11th birthday. In high school exams, how'd you stay up to read? Well, the kid across the street dealt excellent speed. And were classes boring? Is mine not today? Hey, most of the time I was tripping, so I really can't say. And Dad, let's see how truthful you are. You ever high behind the wheel of a car? Man, I thought I was flying a 747 when I sold that car. They scraped it for resin. And Dad, you courted Mom. How'd you make her your own? We drink a lot of vodka and we do methadone. So when he asked me about my past and did I get high, I've been seriously thinking about my reply. I'm gonna lie, 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 lie. Dad, you ever do drugs? No way. Dad, you ever do it with any woman besides Mom? Did you ever see that Fellini movie, Satyricon?
I was 13 the first time, so good I couldn't speak. They should've wrapped me in a hefty bag and drained me twice a week. And Dad, what's the kinkiest that you ever got? Ah, there was a mother and daughter upstate that were crazy, stupid, hot. There was this girl and her dog. We won't get into that. There was these three dominatrixes in a one-room flat. Couple times in a church pew, that was a heavenly thing. There was a girl named Ruth in the booth of the Burger King. My wife's eating a hole through me with her evil eye. My kids got inquiries, they want an honest reply. I'm gonna lie, 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 lie. Dad, did you have premarital sex? Absolutely not. I was like a thespian there, did you notice? Did you ever hear the joke about the guys doing Shakespeare and the people are booing? He's like, hey, I didn't write this shit. I was just thinking this would be...
You know what would be... I'm going to go back to the song in a minute. But if Debbie and her husband were like really fucking kinky, right? And he's like, you know, it's getting a little boring. We've been married for a while. Let's invite a lot of people to our house in the yard and we'll go upstairs and fuck while they're here, right? They won't know. Go at it like fucking animals. Come down. Just you talk a lot about money. They won't know. We're up there fucking. Bye. Sorry.
Is he still playing?
Weddings. I'm good for weddings. Just saying. Now come the tough questions that he's gonna ask. All prosecutors say the hard stuff for less. Dad, did you ever steal from the store when you didn't have the bucks? Hey, from what I remember, most of the stuff just fell off of trucks. And Dad, did you ever own a gun? Well, it wasn't like I had a license for one. And Dad, did you ever steal an automobile for fun? The owners wouldn't have wanted it when we got done. And Dad, I heard you bartended in a place that dealt crack. We were just making sure our clientele would come back. That's a funny line, fuckers. He wants the truth. I look him in the eye. I set a good example. I'm that kind of guy. I'm gonna lie, 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 lie. Dad, did you ever do anything bad? Fuck no. Another song about parenting. So there's a cop stop roadblock for inspection stickers. Maybe it was hot, maybe the cop was assigned to the detail for punishment. Maybe he had witnessed some domestic violence shit last night that once again made him lose faith in humanity. I don't know, and I don't care, because he's an asshole, and he's pissy, and he's barking orders in front of my 10-year-old, who's now afraid and thinking the cops are something to be feared. Hey, fuckface, I'm trying to teach my kid there's some authority that needs to be respected, but we have no respect for you. Now I'm trying to teach him to not get shot. We're at the 7-Eleven, my kid's getting in the car with his big cup and his hot dog, and he leaves the door open while he gets things adjusted. Cop pulls up trying to get the space next to us and he blasts his siren. My kid jumps, smashes his foot in the door as the cop struts by, is not smiling, not saying he's sorry, just trying to look all macho and garner the respect he never got in high school. Hey, fuckface, I'm trying to teach my kid there's some authority that needs to be respected, but we have no respect for you. Now I'm trying to teach him to not get shot. Skateboard park in Chappaqua. Rumor has it the cost was supposed to get a raise, but a skateboard park got built instead. Cop buzzing around like flies on shit, harassing kids, till they finally shut it down. It just wasn't worth it. I was there when it was closed, reading the bulletin board with my 10-year-old. A cop threw us out. I said, you don't have anything better to do? He said, what did you say? I said, listen, you fucking idiot. Know at the end of your life, you've done nothing righteous. You're a worthless piece of shit. Actually, I didn't say that because I didn't want to get shot. But what I should have said was, hey, fuckface, I'm trying to teach my kid there's some authority that needs to be respected, but we have no respect for you. Now I'm trying to teach them to not get shot. Three cops coming in our building from the rear looking all serious as my son and I come in. My son says, why are they here? This makes me nervous. I say, excuse me, you're coming in the building. This makes my son nervous, thinking but not saying because I don't want to get shot. Would it kill you to reassure the kid while you're hanging around? And one of the cops says, we're the good guys. I don't know what alternative planet you're living on, but you're definitely not the good guys. Hey, fuckface. I'm trying to teach my kid there's some authority that needs to be respected, but we have no respect for you. Now I'm trying to teach them to not get shot. I'm white. Thanks. Sorry about that fucking thing. And okay, good. All right.
So what was it like? It was cool, man. We got this like audience participation thing about orgies going. It's fucking awesome, man. Really, yeah. So what are you selling at the merch table? Well, now we've added not only the paintings and the stickers and the CDs, Vaseline with a little bit of sand in there. Makes things fucking interesting. Well, at 40%, I know a lot of you thinking, man, holy shit, for a Saturday in Pflugerville, this is the fucking greatest time I've ever had. I'm afraid my heart might explode. I wonder if this guy has any songs about hate crimes to bum me out. Yes, I fucking do. Yes, I fucking do. It's an old timer's applying for a job, and the interviewer says, what do you think's your worst fault? He says, I think I'm too honest. The interviewer says, I don't think honesty's a fault. The old timer says, I don't give a fuck what you think. Let me tell you this one. Oh, wait. All right. This is new. So it's a guy goes to the dentist, and he's...
A guy goes to the dentist.
And he... Oh, you used the fish island. The guy goes to the dentist, and the dentist looks at his mouth and goes, yeah, you're going to need a full set of dentures, $15,000. And the guy's like, ooh, geez, I don't have dental insurance. It's a lot of money. Dennis says, well, why don't you do a little cost comparative analysis and come back, maybe find something cheaper. Well, he goes around, it's pretty much the same everywhere. And he goes back to the original dentist, what do you suggest? And the dentist says, well, there's a guy down the alley here. Now, I can't vouch for the quality of his work, but I happen to know he's substantially less. So the guy goes down there and he sits in the chair, and that dentist looks at his mouth and goes, yep, gonna need a full set of dentures. It's first day with my new teeth. You think you can get shit on eBay, but you can't. Anyway, because they put the mouth in there for sizing. No, come and we'll have fun. The neighbors, right? The neighbors are like packing up. They're fucking moving, right? Let's go. Let's, but do what Debbie and Steve are doing. Just one time. So he says, yeah, he says, you're going to need a full set of dentures, $300. The guy's, well, that's a lot less. Are they any good? Do they hurt? And the dentist says, well, there's some of my patients out there in the waiting room. Why don't you talk to them? So he approaches one old timer. He says, excuse me, sir. Says, your patient here? Says, yep. Says, you got the dentures? Says, yep. Says, do they hurt you? The old timer says, you know, one time I was out fishing. I was in the middle of the lake, you know, and there's nobody around. It was beautiful. But then I had to go to the bathroom, the big one, number two. And I look around, there's nobody there. So I pulled my pants down, I put my posterior over the side of the boat, and I was proceeding with the process. When all of a sudden I noticed there was another boat with some attractive women. I don't want them to see this, so I jump up. Well, unbeknownst to me, my testicles were caught in the oarlock, and this ripped my scrotum from my crotch. Guy's like, whoa, that's a pretty tough story. That doesn't explain the dentures. He said, that was the only day I remember my dentures not hurting me.
You said that song about hate crimes.
Yes, I have one right here. Who are you going to know? Matthew Shepard, you will know. Brian Denique, you will know. Punk rock kid from Amarillo, Texas, murdered. Of course, Matthew Shepard, gay youth, murdered. And Brandon Tina, trans youth, murdered. So now you know everyone the song. Brandon Tina and Brian Denique met for coffee in heaven last week. And he said, I like mine black. And he said, you ever want to go back? He said, now we can be who we want to be. He said, now we can be who we want to be. Matthew Shepard dropped by for dessert, and they asked Matthew, does it still hurt?
And he paused and spit over the rail. It flew down to earth just like hail. He said, no, we can be who we want to be. He said, no, we can be who we want to be. Well, down on earth, he held her tight, she held her tight, he held him tight, they held them tight. It was the morning, they'd cried all night. Through the window, they saw the hail. And he asked her, have we failed? He said, now, we can be who we want to be. He said, now, we can be who we want to be.
Thanks. Here's a song about the media. Anybody here work for Fox News or have a relative that does? I ask only because your souls are going to burn in hell for eternity, and you might want to weigh that against long lunches or good benefits, I guess. Eternity being what the fuck it is. Right? Watch, watch. This is just a preview of the shit that's coming. Watch this. Doctor, doctor, I think I'm turning invisible.
The doctor can't see you now.
That's why you come, fuckers.
Now temper, temper, little cloud. Thought we was in this together. I got another 30 miles to go and you change your mind like the weather. But I know how you feel though. With that blinding lightning flash, I'm all low now, but I got my guitar. Let's think about some stuff we can smash. Well, I slept last night by the side of the road. Was thinking about the nearest phone. I was wondering if she would accept the charges. I was wondering if I had a banana for a backbone. Then I had a dream about Count Basie, but he didn't want to talk to me. He had a lot of hurt in his face, and he had a copy of Life magazine. Had Elvis on the cover. It had an article inside. Did not say who it was written by. Closer inspection, I noticed that Albert Goldman was still writing, and life wouldn't let him die. Count Basie opened up that magazine to page 30, threw it at me, turned around and walked away. I said, oh man, that's Count Basie, like my hero. We could have hung out. I had so many questions. There was so many things that I wanted to say. But after 10 glossy pages of big Life magazine format, people with guns, knives, smoke, and crack, I stepped back from that magazine. My mouth flew open because all those people were black. I used to work at a bar in Syracuse, New York. We had what we jokingly referred to as an incident most every night. There were drug sales, there was guns, there was people fighting. All those people were white. True story, I pulled a pregnant girl out of the bathroom one time. She was in there over an hour. People complained that she was smoking crack. She was white as snow. She was white as blow. And she was most definitely not black. And I think Count Basie was just trying to point out that if I wasn't careful, I might fall in a trap. Take a look at that magazine. Am I on acid or what? But it appears to me someone's getting a bad rap. Hey, page 36 and 37, there was a Sony ad. It was a white family hanging out by the swimming pool. Couldn't see the mother, just her reflection in the water. She was holding the video camera. What color was she? Well, let's not be a fool. So there we go, in as big as life. And Count Basie, he don't want to talk to me. Miles Davis never rang my phone off the hook, and I'm not anticipating any phone calls from Spike Lee. Roger Manning says something about hatred and being any color and being not as I look around this whole big world, not just this room here tonight or any room in this building, any building in this street, street in this city, city in this state in this country, country in this whole big world. It's blue, baby blue. That's the color we all got. Well, not Tampa, little cloud. Thought we was in this together. I got another 30 miles to go and you change your mind like the weather. But I know how you feel though with that blinding lightning flash. I'm all alone now, but I got my guitar. Let's think about some stuff we can't smash. Let's think of some stuff we can't smash.
Sincerely, because I fuck around a lot, but occasionally my heart is pure. I hope you didn't lose anybody to the plague. I was checking my balance on Chaseler. Seems I got a private message on Facebook. Should get used to this stuff. I'm getting older still. I deny my mentality. I probably never will. You were skinny as a rail, smoking selling menthol green. Reservation carton, smoke them like a fiend. We were doing acid and we were 15. Music in our bedroom, Hendrix and Cream. They say the cancer tore through your frame. I had to quit doing drugs, but there ain't no blame. I lost touch with you, and that's a shame. The mirror says I changed, but I feel the same. Remember you dated that guy, roadie for hair on Broadway? He found Jesus, tested in an odd way. Naked in the snow was his plan. He froze to death. Jesus saves, but not on demand. Makeup in our teens to look like Bowie. Running from the cops on the go. See, hiding pot in our locker until there's a raid. Getting three new albums because we just got paid. I lost touch with you as the years roll on, and I should have reached out, and now you're gone. I feel you smiling, though, guiding my walk. And your pain's over now, and I wish we could talk, and you're gone now. I should have reached out. And you're gone now. I should have reached out. My old friend. Tripping with you in my parents' bedroom. Took a while to kick in, then I hit our heads, boom. Ordered pizza when it came, our appetites beat. The pepperoni screaming, don't eat meat. Your brother bleeding everywhere, tooth through his lip. Happened at the state fair, tried to do a flip. You wouldn't go to ER, tweaking in his head. You gave him homemade stitches and you nursed him instead. Working at the guitar place, you come down and see me. Talk about our parents, my mother had the DTs. Blood on the walls until they rushed her. They brought her to St. Joe's and the morphine hushed her. Your father losing the red, batting at the track. You were laughing, your mom was screaming, don't come back. He come back when he won, she beat him like a spastic. Had nine kids, Catholics don't use prophylactics. I leave a space if you want to laugh. Perfect. Well, the town's beat now, shootings everywhere. Heroin's the rage, the kids don't care. They ain't no jobs, poverty's ballistic. Poorest per capita, it's a national statistic. You're in a better place, the end to your pain. I might not make it to heaven, I won't see you again. I feel you smiling though, smoking your butt. I'll make you laugh again though, I feel it in my gut. Couple of dirty jokes, maybe a funny story. Hear me screaming a monk from purgatory. You're gone now, I should've reached out. You're gone now, I should've reached out. My old friend. Some people are stupid as shit. Some people are dumber than dirt. And their meanness just won't quit. And
and they live their lives to hurt. Kill them all. Kill them all.
Weddings.
From palaces of gold, their smug laughs resonate. From mom's basement in the cold, they type their spewing hate. And they mumble, can barely spell. Pen pushers steal their souls. At the rally, hear them yell as the carny checks the polls. Kill them all. Kill them all. No shame on the TV. Bloated egos consumed with lust. Uniforms on a killing spree. No concern with what is just. And it's useless to negotiate. They've proven no compromise. Useless to useless to sympathize. Check the mirror. Are you brown? Buy a gun. Lord knows you have that right. Arm yourself. Go to town. Go swiftly to the night. You see a flag, a Nazi sign. Burning crosses, torches lit. They call you fag. Are you resigned? 'Cause this ain't no time to quit. And a monster, now I'm called. No conscience, no regret. You put my back against the wall, and history won't forget. Before I go into the last chorus, which I anticipate to be a sing-along, at some point in my career, I know I'm going to do that America's Got Talent. And this is the song, in fact, I will do. Now, parenthetically, I have a confession to make. You know how there's some celebrities, they haven't done anything to overtly offend you, but they just, there's something about them you fucking hate. I hate fucking Howie Mandell. I hate Howie Mandell. There's something so pretentiously phony about him. So if I ever do this on America's Got Talent, I'd like to do it as a performance art piece where I would fuck Howie Mandel in the ass as I sang the song. And you know as well as I do that Howie, who is a germaphobe from what I understand, would actually go through with it because he knows that the ratings would go up. And this is actually true. I played Minneapolis, and afterwards I got a private message on Facebook. It was a woman. She says, hey, thanks for coming to Minneapolis, and I love the show, but I'd like to talk to you about the anal rape, you know? And I'm thinking, where the fuck were you sitting, you know? But I said, anal rape? What are you talking about? She said, well, you anally raped Howie Mandel. And I said, no, he was a willing participant in this. He lost his lust for celebrity and money. Well, he doesn't give a fuck. I can fuck him in the... And I don't think Simon likes Howie that much, so you know as well as he'd be going like, that's pretty good. Can I see it again? Everybody would sing, kill them all. Kill them all. Watch them fall. Kill them all. I'm a Libra, I need balance. God called down from the sky. Said, I told you. Don't care. I don't care for loving. please don't kill for hate. Don't kill in my name. Don't kill for heaven's sakes. Don't kill, don't kill, don't kill. Once again, you didn't understand me. Disobeyed from all I can detect. From what I remember, I didn't more than ask ya. I commanded it from what I recollect. Thou shalt, what part of thou shalt not kill don't you understand? Was it the thou part that threw you? Thou means you. Was it the shall not part that may have confused you? Shall not means fucking don't. Don't care, don't care, don't care. I know divinely sanctioned murders. Who know better than me? I'm God, how come you don't hear me? I've been saying the same shit for centuries. You see, it's me, that's your worship. All your Christians, all your Muslims, and your Jews. I'm gonna say it again one more time. Don't kill your fucking neighbor. Jesus Christ, that shouldn't be new. Don't care, don't care. I thought I etched this in stone. Thanks. Well, we're at about 66%. Two-thirds, and I don't get here as often as I like, if truth be told. Again, my heart is pure, because I certainly do. Texas, man. Texas has been very good to me. I got no problem with Texas. Awesome. And so if you had some requests, I would be honored to honor a couple of them at this juncture.
Blood of the Wolf.
Blood of the Wolf. You got it.
John Lennon.
What is it?
John Lennon.
Okay.
Do you have any songs about that guitar?
Yeah. Okay. Big, lengthy, fast, spoken word, all three of them. Okay, all right, okay. All right, let me do one. For those of you that don't play the guitar but have always wanted to, I'll give you a quick lesson, and this is actually a lesson, it's true lesson that got me fired from a teaching position I once had in Albany, New York. The names of the strings are E-A-D-G-B-E. Good way to remember that. Every acid dealer gets busted eventually. I interpret that as an anti-drug message. Little Josh's mom did not concur. And I was out on the fucking street. Here we go. Okay, let me do this real little one for you. This is one of those minute, deboot minute ones. For a billionaire, I guess that you're okay. So about this rocket ship to the moon thing. This planet needs a lot of help, okay. So build a frickin' school, hey, hey, or two or three or four. I'll tell you why in a second. Jeff Bezos, you seem like a big fucking jerk. No one needs a $500 million boat. So build a school, or two or three or four. Why? People are stupid. When he was 15 years old, already balding, thin, basketball etched frame, continuously, nervously bang against the box only he could see, my friend Frank robbed a Kentucky Fried Chicken with a fork.
He courted the girl that worked there on a rAwTiMe. Her girlfriends thought she was way off to go out with a boy that talked like an electric circuit. And they had it all worked out, except she must have got cold feet on the day of the ride because she called in sick. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon in the 85-degree, blue-collar, melancholy sun, disguised in his red and yellow striped wool ski mask, armed with a stainless steel fork and 15 years of Catholic Italian longings, Frank ran into the Kentucky Fried Chicken in the corner of Butternut and Lodi, and finding no one behind the counter, he yelled to the two people sitting at the booth eating their original recipe breasts, "Everybody hit the deck!" And they looked up at him and they laughed. The manager sauntered no too casually out from the back room, and Frank screamed again, this time slamming his fork down so hard on the counter that he cut his own hand. And the three people saw the blood and the unrelenting fierceness and the eyes behind the ski mask, and they knew he was serious. Through the dusty and street plate glass window, passerbys could easily have witnessed three people huddled on the ground in a masked Frank. Fork gripped him midair as he jammed down the register button, grabbed $214, and fled. First time he told me this story was 15 years later on a blustery evening. We were broke down in the sub-zero snow this side of the Canadian border. That lonely orange U-Haul squeaking with every jet of northern icy wind provided a refuge in its cab for 8 hours. Me and Frank in the front sharing cigarettes, later end buds, flannel shirts that had been discarded in earlier months, summer days. Come on, you snakes, the sun had called. Shed those skins to lie forgotten behind the seats but now taken out and used as blankets, stuffed into door cracks to guard against the razor chill. After a few hours in the Bourne and Pete, and the conversation snowballed and turned heated and sillier, confessional, redeeming. Frank told me about his Italian grandmother, how she would stare at his carved body, every inch of which was covered with a thick, rug-like hair, and she would shake her head Sicilian serious, and she would moan in broken English, "Blood of the wolf! Blood of the wolf!" In that truck, Frank threw back his head and howled with laughter. Then he told me how he robbed a Kentucky Fried Chicken with a fork, and I screamed in laughter, "A fork! A fucking fork!" So hard I actually got warm for a few minutes. When they found us 8 blue bone cold chill hours later, I was half asleep. But Frank was still doing imitations of his boyhood hero, AC/DC's Bon Scott, yelling, "And they made it out with a bullet in their back across the Canadian snow." That was 8 years ago. Frank drives for somebody else. I moved to Texas. We couldn't make a go of our business in upstate New York, and the bank repossessed our truck. Last night, when I was headed to the CD player, I thought I heard that truck outside beeping. I rode in that truck for half a decade. I know the sound of it and Frank's loud, impatient black coffee and VHU's horn blast. I was ready to ride. But when I went to the window, there was no truck. And as my eyes scanned the Texas horizon, I thought I saw running behind the trees a boy. He was wearing a ski mask. He was holding a fork. Woo! 71%. You want to come up? You want to do it? Ladies and gentlemen, Detroit Hamell.
Hello. A guy with a premature ejaculation problem comes out of nowhere.
Raise the IQ, fuckers.
Donald Trump walks into a bar with a frog on his head, and the bartender said, "What's up with that?" And the frog said, "Well, it started with a wart on my ass, and it turned into this." My mom asked for some chapstick. I gave her some super glue. She still isn't talking to me. That's why I'm here with my dad. All right. This next joke is my favorite joke of all time. But it's one of those jokes where people either hate it or they love it. And so I'm going to tell it to you now. There's been complete silence. There's been laughter. So I'm excited. It's a sociological experiment, as my dad likes to say. All right. So a guy walks into a bar and he sees at the end of the bar there's a man sitting with a big, giant orange head. So the guy goes and sits next to the guy with the big, giant orange head. And he said, "What's up with that?" And the guy with the big, giant orange head said, "All right, I'll tell you. One day I was walking home and I saw alongside the road there was a lamp. So I picked it up, I rubbed the lamp, and a genie came out. And the genie said, 'I will grant you 3 wishes.' So the guy with the big, giant orange head said, 'All right, for my first wish, I would like to have $1 million. And just like that, I had $1 million in my bank account. And the genie said, "All right, your wish is granted. How about your second wish?" So the guy with the big giant orange head said, all right, for my second wish, I would like to have the most beautiful wife in the world. And just like that, I had a ring on my ring finger, and the most beautiful woman was standing right next to me. And the genie said, all right, your wish is granted. How about your third wish? So the guy with the big giant orange head said to the guy at the bar, here's where I think I messed up. For my third wish, I wish for a big giant orange head.
All right.
Fuck you, right. That's awesome.
Okay, so a guy walks into a bar with a chicken pot pie on his head, with a pink donut on top of the chicken pot pie, and it's tied around his chin with some beef jerky. And the bartender said, listen, I don't like to get into people's business, but what's up with this? And the guy goes, well, on every Tuesday, my family gets together. We take a chicken pot pie. We put it on our head. We take a pink donut. We put it on top of the chicken pot pie, and it's tied around our chin with some beef jerky. And the bartender said, well, you know it's Wednesday, right? And the guy goes, really? I must look like a real asshole to you. There are two 10-year-old kids smoking at a bus stop. A man in a truck pulls in. He's about middle-aged. He said, you kids shouldn't be doing that. You can get diseases and cancer, and you can die from doing that. And one of the 10-year-old kids said, my grandfather lived till he was 90 years old. And the man in the truck said, oh, yeah, was he a smoker? The kid said, no, but he minded his own fucking business. All right, my last one. Thank you. This one I used to tell when I was like 7, 8, would be the one joke I'd tell and then get off the stage. So a UPS delivery man rings a doorbell. A 10-year-old kid comes out. He's got a scotch in one hand, he's got a cigarette in another, and he's wearing women's underwear. So the UPS driver said, hey, are your parents home? The kid says, what do you think?
Let's do it.
If you think you can't go on, if your soul's lost a chance, lost a hope and face neglect, like, if you need protection from, cause the world is crazy scum, if the water's at your nose and you're on your tippy toes, you're safe there. I said you, you're safe there. If they do not get the joke, your dreams are up in smoke, you're safe here. If the bank has lost its smile, heaven's burned your file, you're safe here. If the house was in a flood and the preacher's dumb as mud, if you cuppered on your shoes, then you got your baby blues. If the gun's a man and drawn, burning crosses on your lawn. If the sheriff's drunk as hell, cause wait in the holding cell. You're safe in. Square peg in a round hole, he's gonna take it all. I was sitting at the end of the bar there when the back of the crowd goes high. Strangers thinking through the door, tricked up, boots to the basement floor. Listen, no one needs to scratch a catchy tune and spoke of death. Holes in his hands, hoodie and sore, and sergeant's beard, eyes were worn. Next to me, he took a seat and he said, hey, pilgrim, tell me me. What's your pleasure? What's your style? I ain't seen you for a while. 4 days later, I woke in the dirt, noose on my neck, blood in my shirt, didn't know what's in the bonus. Then sent him a joke to do it again. I guess I cause a hall of shame. After midnight in the rain, the clothes of fries, the crud is bare. I'm in heavy underwear and you. God save me. Trapping in a round hole, it's gonna fuck your soul. If the doctor turns and cries, runs out of alibis, you're safe here. If the law says none shall pass, the devil's on your ass, you're safe here. You see the haters, instigators, all the verbal masturbators, all the trollers, BS worlders, all the wonders, belly puller, the junkies and the flunkies and the bosses and the monkeys, all the stalkers and the gawkers, the haters are talkers. You're safe here. Trapping it around home, it's gonna fuck your soul.
Ladies and gentlemen, Detroit Hammer.
Yep. All right. We had a couple requests, and then we're going to come into... Yeah, thanks for coming, you guys. I'm having a good time. Thank you very much. Yeah. Let me do the guitar one. I haven't done this one or the other one. The alto. So yeah, this is a song that I wrote for my guitar. My guitar was made in 1937. And I often think about the people in the Gibson factory if they could have looked ahead 70 years. But offstage, I pamper it. It's true. And not Kissimmee. That's Florida. Kalamazoo, Michigan. The K. Multisyllabic. And the K is what threw me. I'm giving you insight into what goes on up here. You don't want to go there. You don't want to go there. It's not fun. Anyway. But yeah, so then I was playing Detroit one night. Nothing anybody fucking wants to see, trust me. But hey, right? I felt it was time to commit. Like 3 o'clock in the morning, and I see Kalamazoo, and it's like, oh, that's... So I went, and the factory is still there, mostly closed off. It looks like about 10% in the back. Heritage guitars, which are beautiful, for those of you that play, Gibson guitars, luthiers, some of them stayed. The other ones moved to, like, Nashville and I think Memphis. There's two Gibson factories, but a bunch of the original people. So I put it up against the door and took some pictures. It was freezing cold, where I put my headlights and everything. Not all the shit's interesting, but I mean, him and I, we've told the same fucking stories to each other now for, like, so I got you guys here, and I'm going to tell you stories about my guitar. And I guess I like mature porn, too, since I'm being confessional. I like the amateur, mature shit. That's it. Okay. Okay. Cold, bitter day, the street deserted, the music store the only shop open. I stand outside, my hands are jammed in my empty pockets. A bunch of guitars crowd eager in the front, but an old battered acoustic in the back spoke to me. Cracked whisper voice, hey buddy, you wanna go for a ride? I'm skeptical, this guitar's almost dust. I say, what you got in mind, old timer? That guitar pushed its way to the front, saintly, sincere. Go for a ride, boy, ancient faces, chariot races, forbidden places, exotic embraces, pyramid construction, camel riding, time machine gliding, white light fever believer, ride to thunder, Texaco, Mexico, gas guy, siphon hose, no nose, ride the lightning, ride the wild surf, ride a white swan, Jenny, take a motherfucking ride for God's sake. I said, whoa, hold on there, chatty baby. I say, how old are you anyway, guitar? That guitar said, I was born in 37, I'm the rule by 11, I can play as sweet as an axe from heaven, but I need a partner to start here, like the James boys, Frank and Jesse, like the Untouchables with Elliot Nessie, like Bonnie and Clyde when they get aggressy, Romeo and Juliet when they start their caressy, Bartles and James a pause to refreshy, Salt and Pepper like to see him undressy, Sid and Nancy dead and gone, God blessy, like the Everly brothers, how the voices they measure, Jake LaMotta and his brother Joe Pesci. How much you cost anyway, guitar? That guitar said, that's a mere $200, which was in fact true at the time. And I said, well, I only got a mere $10, which was in fact true at the time. And that guitar said, well, you go through the door over there and you give that $10 to the man behind the counter. It's called a layaway and you pay the balance off quick, you know, when your ship comes in. So I gave that man the $10 and you know, I waited for my ship to come in. I go down the dock every day, my little boating sneakers, my sailor's cap, my Thurston Howell, the third blazer, my fish sticks. I bought binoculars, I scanned the seven seas, no ship. I launched flares, went to nautical school. I got a job as a longshoreman. I learned how to walk like Marlon Brando when on the waterfront. Studied Moby Dick, I got a tattoo, the red Ishmael, no ship. I sold sails, drank with pirates, yo-ho, holding a bottle of rum. I composed sea shanties, rented Jaws, watched reruns of The Love Boat. I collected coral, lived in a lighthouse, bought scuba gear. I hired divers to raise a Titanic. I took the confession of the old man of the sea. I bribed Charlie Tuna. I saw three ships come sailing in on Christmas Day. On Christmas Day, bingo ships, but not mine. You know, I anticipated a very cold winter of ice fishing, but my ex-wife paid off the guitar as a birthday present. Epilogue. Crime and Punishment, love story. The Crying Game, love story. Brokeback Mountain, absolutely a love story. All this bullshit about the guitar ultimately distills to a love story. Now I gotta write the hooky chorus for the big hit record, and just like Justin Bieber, I'm gonna bring home the fucking bacon. It's a love story. It's a love story. It's a love story. Yeah. you. So the poem, I got a poem, because I was dating this gal and I had to meet her parents. So this is entitled Meet the Parents. Stress and anxiety, you're headed to the door, your girlfriend's parents you never met before, but you love the daughter, so you're rising to the chore and you're building the future, that's the score. The house has got the old people smell and the TV's so loud you gotta yell. Sean Hannity's evil, I can tell, and the parents are glued. This is gonna be hell, but they greet you nice. Loud Fox News, and you think, yeah, they're entitled to their views. Emphasis on entitled as you look around the house, but your girlfriend's cool, so you're quiet as a mouse. Of course, she's kicking you under the table, and you want to say something, but you ain't able. Maybe go outside and cut the cable so the volume goes down and your brain gets stable, and they're passing the potatoes, and the parents inquire, what is it that you do? And you start to perspire. You say, I'm a musician, and the looks get weird, like maybe you got the potatoes stuck in your beard. They say, ain't the arts tough in this economy? And you want to say, your boy Trump dropped a bomb on me. I'm just a musician. Is that a sin? If I was a cop or politician, you'd let me in. Them assholes could be despicable. I only play notes in your girlfriend's evil eye. That's all she wrote, so you suck it up and say, I get by, and you can see where she inherited the evil eye. And they're passing the food, and you make your selection. The old man says, you want to see my gun collection? You take the chicken, a breast in the wing, and you say, sure, pops, more than anything. And that TV's screaming, and so is your brain, and you're constantly editing and total refrain. They say they're Christians. Thank God for Trump. Your girlfriend holds you back so you don't jump. Mom is patting the Bible. You want to stab her. You want to say Jesus ain't no pussy grabber. But you hold your tongue and seal your lips and grab the table in a vice-like grip. You want to say Jesus ain't no handicapped mocker. And here's another thing that might come as a shocker. He wouldn't separate parents and kids at the border, but you don't say shit to keep etiquette order. And the table talk and the constant chatter, and the old man's talking about Blue Lives Matter. You want to send some of these assholes to the electric chair, but your girlfriend's squeezing your balls, so you don't dare. Then he starts talking about the NFL, how these black players should go to hell. Oh, it upsets you when the black players kneel? This disrespects the flag? Well, here's the deal. When Trump defends Nazis, he pisses on the lives of every American soldier in World War II that died. Trump disrespects the flag, no matter how you play it, and I hate fucking football. I don't say it, and your girlfriend's proud, you're so polite. You think, cool, maybe a little lovemaking that night. Daddy's got the hat, make America great. And Mama says, these libtards, why they gotta hate? Then something clicks and your brain goes red. Redder than the head on the redneck daddy's head. Can't take it no more. My mouth went in attack. This was the straw that broke the Hamell's back. Couldn't take it. I'm one of these libtards. I don't hate no more anymore than I hate a cockroach crawling across the floor. It's gross and disgusting like maggots. It's annoying. Just want them gone, so the raid I'm employing. Cockroaches ain't worthy of hate, my friend. I just want them gone, make my kitchen great again. Now, Mom, when you say libtards, you're a name-calling fucker. Liberals got names for conservatives, clan dick sucker. So I got some questions. Where do I begin? How you like them clam balls banging against your chin? And Dad, you're hoarding guns for your protection. You don't think that minorities have their own gun collection? That hat so red for a target that'll pass come the revolution, gonna shoot your right ass. Yeah, I'm on a roll, pass the butter. Don't talk, Daddy, don't talk, Mother. Ever since this election, it's like a diagnosis of cancer. And yes, sometimes I do think violence is the answer. Ever since this election, here's the situation. There's been no talk of affordable education. Politicians love the low IQ. They get the votes and the money from idiots like you. Well, dinner was great. On dessert, I'm gonna pass. Take your daughter home, you know she loves it in the... The ride home was quiet. She was mad, I could tell, but for the first Meet the Parents, I think it went pretty well. By request. In eighth grade, I was short, had glasses, and a squeaky-ass voice that refused to change. Two things dominated my thoughts: James Cartino and John Lennon. Cartino I came in contact with daily, and gym class. Repeat the shit out of me at every opportunity. Lennon I came in contact with in my wildest dreams. In 1971, John Lennon spent a week in my hometown of Syracuse, New York. Yoko gave an exhibiting museum there. Some friends of mine skipped school and got hired to do odd jobs for her. I tell them about my day of Cartino poundings. They tell me about their day with John and Yoko. I was envious as hell.
My friends told me there was to be a private party and I begged them to sneak me in. They were skeptical but agreed. I waited outside the museum for about 8 hours. I had to piss real bad. I didn't dare leave. At about midnight, the back door opened and I snuck in. I couldn't believe my luck. I'd be invisible. I'd watch. I'd wait. The room was dark and crowded. I saw Allen Ginsberg and some others I recognized, but no Jod and Yoko. After an hour, I felt I could risk a much-needed trip to the men's room. I made my way through the crowd, entered a hallway, took a few steps, and looked up to see Lennon approaching. A crew from the party had targeted him, and from behind me, they rushed. I was carried, it seemed, in slow motion, on a path, straight as a bullet. Closer! 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 To my chest! Slammed it to John Lennon's. John Lennon looked down at me and barked, "Fuck off." It sucked to be me. I hit the men's room. Hometown buzz from Lennon's visit lasted a month. For me, of course, it lasted longer. Cartino thrashed me the following Monday, but didn't seem to hurt as much. Something had changed for all my life. I didn't cry when Lennon was murdered. I was angry, bewildered. I respected him so much, I may even have felt guilty. Last year, while getting my baggage at LaGuardia Airport, I found myself next to his son, Sean. Tall, handsome like his father, with his mother's beautiful eyes. The son Lennon never got to see become a man. And now that I'm a father, I understand this more than ever. It was then I noticed I was crying. I just have two more for you. This is a new one, a sing-along. I retired my old sing-along, and now I got a new sing-along. You'll know it. I won't make it. Because normally, let's be frank, I do a lot of stadiums for 50, 60,000 people, and it's easy to get them. But I asked Deb, I said, Deb, could you make it more of an elite thing where we only got like about 20 people, but people I really liked and were really smart and cool. And she said, I could do that for you, Ed. So there's about 50,000 people down at the 7-Eleven trying to get in. We won't let them fucking in. I'm just doing it for you. And then he started sucking his own dick. It was awesome. It's fucking one of the greatest moments of dick sucking I ever saw. He must have had like that vertebrae taken out. Oh my God. He was so pliable. Oh. Okay. This is from my new album. Every song will end in bloodshed. Bring the kids. Young Mother Hubbard went to the cupboard, but the cupboard was bare. She paused a moment there. She thought about her kids, and she thought about their eyes, and she thanked Christ for the lunches that the school provide. But there wasn't no dinner, and did she have it in her? Could she sneak around the store? Could she steal a little more? Cause that dick of a manager caught her before, but she was quicker than him, but dropped the steaks on the floor. And sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Ain't it the truth, Ruth? Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Yeah, you gotta eat, Pete. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. There ain't no mercy, Percy. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Swallow your pride, Clyde. She stared in the mirror and she put on a big pants. She could stuff them real good if she only got the chance. She looked at the gauge, she was low on gas. She thought about the landlord, he's been staring at her ass. Shaw was cold in the freezer aisle. The grocery boy stared, she fixed him with a smile. Some of her friends were living in a box. She thought about that, she stole another chop. And sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. That's a fact check. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. The bottom line, Einstein. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Ain't it clear, Shakespeare? Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. I ain't shitting, kitten. was headed home with the backseat full. The security guard, she had to give a little pull. She cleaned her hands, she made plans. When the kid saw the food, they would do headstand. She was covered for a week, where's a stimulus check? Don't think about the rent, you'll become a nervous wreck. She let the top of her thong beckon from her pants beneath the landlord's window, where she knew he'd give a glance. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. You gotta eat, Pete. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. It won't affect your soul, Rayol. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Don't be starving, Marvin. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Suck a little dick, Rick. You'd be saying... Weddings
again.
But so you would sing that, you'd sing, sometimes you gotta do, and then I'd fill it in with the thing. Let's try. One, two, ready, sing. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Things have gotten freaky, Enrique. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Oh, I ain't lying, Brian. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. That's a fact, Jack Loud. Sometimes you gotta do what you gotta do to get through. Suck a little dick, Rick. I oughta know, Joe. I could do this all day, Ray. Thanks. Actually, now I have two more. But this is new from the new album. Every song could end in bloodshed, too. And this is good. I'll do this song. I've been constructing over the tour. I sort of build a little thing that, set. So at Dan's last night, it was 90% was, I was very proud. And then last time, it's modular. It's modular in here, and I fuck with it a little bit. So I know, but a lot of you I know are thinking, is he going to do a religious song? Yes, I got one for you. Fuck it. When you're talking about the president, you're talking about the White House resident who thinks that he is heaven sent. He might be. Except that it ain't like you see. He ain't no great hope spiritually. God sent him on a quest to extract a fee comically. And just like Hitler stopped the UK and curtailed their imperialist ways, God sent this turd to the USA, you see. He'll dance and prance and mumble loud and rile the foos up in the crowd and all the genocide that you are proud for me. All you Christians better pray. You better pray. You better pray. There ain't no God. All you Christians better pray. You better pray. You better pray that there ain't no God. Now, prior to this administration, if I reviewed the situation, I had no problem with the Christian nation, you see. I might have thought to each his own. I might have thought what's etched in stone. Do your thing, leave me alone, agree. But after money, it's a brutal fact. It's religion causing folks to act in hostile ways in violent pacts, you see. And if there's a God, you better fear. On all them judgments you hold dear, you're bound for hell to burn severe eternally. All you Christians better pray. Better pray. You better pray that there ain't no God. All you Christians better pray. You better pray. You better pray that there ain't no God. Now, God used locusts, he used floods, he used frogs, he spilled blood, buried nations in fields of mud, biblically. And Satan laughs as they place the pawn, and the ripple spread as the evil spawn, and it met with silence and a yawn, tragically. But if hell awaits, you better bet, evangelicas, when the fires met, their burning flesh, their tears were wet, futilely. And I know the judgments you'll receive, hence the punishments you'll receive, and I thank the heavens I don't believe religiously. All you Christians better pray. You better pray. You better pray. There ain't no God. All you Christians better pray. You better pray. You better pray that there ain't no God. Well, this is my last one. I want to thank you very much for coming. I guess Deb's going to ask me a couple questions after, but I have one more song. But I do want to talk to you because I've been thinking about something. Well, you know, because my son and I have toured since he was 6 years old, and go across the country, spring breaks, and his mother's great mother, but it was 50-50, but he lived with me because of the zip code and the schools, and it really worked out great. But anyway, so we would travel the country, and over the last administration, those 4 years, hold on, let me get a slurp, hold on. It fucked me up. It fucked me up, hardcore. And this, I'm going to tell you when I knew for sure. Because you kept thinking, I want it to be over. Every day, Twitler would get on there. And he would do that shit. And it was, you'd be bludgeoned. It was like being in an abusive relationship. And the gaslighting, 5-6 times a fucking day. And the worst, the lowest common denominator of humanity. I consider myself, I consider myself a people person. I travel the world. I talk to taxi drivers. I talk to guys at the airport. I'll tell you right now, if you're a writer and you want to find out anybody's life story, here's how easy it is. You get in the cab and you say to the taxi driver, how long you been working today? And he'll invariably say, 17 hours. And then you say, how many days this week? And he'll say, 7. And you'll say, you see your wife and all? He goes, I go home for lunches. I said, when's the last time you had a day off? 42 days ago. Shit with all the time, you know, and that fucking Trump administration, you know, the employment rate. Yeah, of course the employment. You got to have 3 fucking jobs to pay the rent, you prick, right? So I became very misanthropic, and I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be that guy. And this is where it culminated for me. I'm at an airport, and this had to be prior to the pandemic. So I'm in an airport. And when you're in an airport now, you know, you got to carry everything with you no matter where you go. So you got your guitar, and you got a couple bags, and you have a hoodie. It was in the winter, and my coat, my hat, you know. And across from me, there was an elderly couple. And she's in a wheelchair, and he's an elderly man. And they're nice. I mean, before that fucker, right? I mean, it doesn't surprise me that a billionaire is a fucking asshole. But, that, you know, that's not a big... But that 73 million people would vote for him after the shit we went through... I like, that's fucking it, you know? And I really do, I mean, for all the shit I give it, I do love the country. I mean, the contract of the country is a humane contract. But we know it's a bunch of white, we all know it's a bunch of white slave owners that put the contract together. But we can rise above that. I mean, Obama, and I got plenty of problems with Obama, but he was going for the highest. He wouldn't fucking play that lowest common denominator card. He just wouldn't do it. You know, God bless him for that, you know? So I'm across, and before the Trump thing, I would talk to anybody, man. And I don't talk about religion sometimes. I don't talk about politics. I'm pretty opinionated about music, so I don't talk to them about music. But I talk to them about other shit, like their job and how they get food on the fucking table. And 99.9% of the time, I would walk away, not knowing their politics, not knowing their religion. It's a good dude. Fuck, he's just trying to put food on the table. So now there's this elderly couple. And she's in a wheelchair. And he's an old guy. And he's got the flannel and the baseball cap or whatever, you know. But they're kind of affectionate. He's taking care of her. It's sort of sweet, you know. And I'm looking at him. A little bit of smile. And I get up and I got to go get to water or something. And as I get up, I travel about 30 feet. And there's a tap on my back. And I turn around. It's the guy. And obviously, I drop my hat. And he gives me my hat. Now, and this is where I fucking hated Trump. That was it. That was the straw that broke the camel's back. Because at that point, man, I just thought, normally, I would think, this is a good dude. But at that point, I thought, he might be a good dude. But I have some questions I have to ask him. And if he doesn't answer those questions the way I think he should, I won't like him.
I love whores. Oh, drunks and thieves and whores. And what's more, the poor I find more trustworthy than lawyers, politicians, and media magicians. I love sluts. Oh, crazy, drugged up sluts that stab your guts. I love the nuts, the whacked, the cracked, the once employed, now sacked. I love them. They're my brothers. They're my sisters. They're my mothers. I love the lost. Repeating tragedy at any cost. Can't take no boss. To deride them, inside them, there's feelings. They can't hide them. So they show it and they blow it. And they're gone before you know it. We're all chumps. Beautiful chumps with righteous lumps and sacred bumps. But we rise from our dumps. Fate will tease us. Whores will squeeze us. And I love them. Just like Jesus. I love whores. Thank you very much for coming. I am Hamell on trial. Had a really good time. Thanks, Dad.
Thanks
for having me. Peace, motherfuckers. Ooh. Don't smoke crack and buy my shit. Would it kill you?
Yeah. Well, no, it won't. I guarantee you that there's no anthrax over there. You're not going to... I've been watching too much Manifest. Never mind. So, Ed, I got a question for you.
Yeah.
Because this is direct support, and so we talk about the money here, because I want everyone to go away a little more educated about what it costs to be an independent musician these days.
My wife.
Well, I mean, get her on.
My wife.
So we sold 27 tickets tonight. That translates into $405 for Ed. Actually, it translates into $305 for Ed, because we give our sound engineer $100. So... we're up to $305 in this telethon. There's a merch table over there. I like to see the artist walk away with $1,000 from every show. Can we do that? Do you think we can make it happen?
I can steal shit out of your house. You make that fucking happen.
Let's see what we can do, okay? Let's see what we can do. Yes.
If nothing else, even if you don't buy the shit, you really should meet my son. Really. Do yourself a fucking... check out the kid. The kid's awesome, man.
He is amazing. Ed, I don't know if you remember. We're from Detroit. I don't know if you remember. Steve and I are from Detroit, the city of Detroit.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's right.
Like, there's just so much meaning here.
I introduced him to Iggy one time, and Iggy was like, cool name.
Yeah.
He's like 6 or 7. Cool name.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
And so many people get it wrong about why you have your tattoo.
They think that, like...
that you love the city that much or something.
I do, yeah. It's the music from the city.
It's the music.
Like, it was a lot of people think, oh, is that where the inception happened of the child? And I, like, no, it'd be in the fucking Chevy Nova would be the same.
Yeah. So tell us, what are you working on right now?
That'd be cool. My son, Chevy Nova.
Right. Yeah, and everyone who speaks Spanish would just be laughing at you for calling a kid Nova. Yeah. What are you working on right now, and what does it cost?
What am I working on? Well, many things.
Yes.
The painting thing came very organically, spontaneously. Prior to 2008, I was on Ani DeFranco's label for 12 years, and you could tour with her, and you get done with the show, and literally you could sell 300 or 400 CDs. And then in 2008... honest to God, this is not an exaggeration. You'd sell 3 or 4 CDs. So the painting thing was... and then my friend Alejandro Escovedo, I'd gone to his house in Austin, and I used to have, like, framed posters, and Alejandro had original art, and it was just cooler. So then I went to galleries, and it was too expensive. so that I just started doing it myself. And now people want to bring stuff home. So I'm always working on that. And then during the pandemic, well, a couple things happened during the pandemic. I had done a bunch of live streams. People were shockingly generous. It was very loose, but I kind of ran out of material. So I wrote 14 songs specific to the pandemic in 14 days. And that I did the live stream pandemic thing. And then Robert Christgau, the rock critic, had called me and said, hey, Ed, did you do a pandemic live stream? People are putting out CD, an EP. You could do something to that. But I had done so well with the live streams. I was actually had money in the bank. So I called Jeff Smith from the Hickoids and Saucetex Records. That's one of the labels I'm on. And I said, hey, Jeff, I'd like to give this to charity. And he said, I'm in immediately. He was in immediately. And then he deals a lot with the food bank. So we printed up 300, which sold out in one day. And we got $3,000. But it's a nickel a meal. It's a nickel a meal. Yeah. So we got, I don't know, it was like something like 30,000 or 60,000 meals. I'd never really been in a position to be charity. Yeah. So yeah. I think he did a little more pressing, so there's some of that on Amazon. I don't get of it, but I love it that it sells. Yeah. And I'm working on an album, I told you, which is the biggest production I've ever done. But I found a little genius a couple towns over, a producer guy. And we just fuck around. It's going to be cool. So that'll be out, I hope, this year. I would assume on Saucetex Records. And I don't know. Jeff will. Yeah, don't worry. It's gravity. Big gusts of gravity. Don't worry about it. It's not your fault. And then, because you've seen my jowls, and you'll see how they get sucked to the earth. So that shit. So I don't know. There'll probably be some weird colored vinyl bundle package. But go to Saucetex. If you don't follow Saucetex, you should. He sends out a newsletter. And then you'll know when the release is. Follow me on Facebook and
SAUSTEX is Saucetex Records.
Correct.
Yep. Yes.
Jeff's
yes.
a great fucking guy. Real
follow
great guy.
On Facebook. You have a website. I found it. It's in the
org. Yeah, TamelonTrial.org as opposed
dot
to
org. Right. Right. Because.
But I'm always the Facebook thing
you're
for
a
me. I mean, there's Instagram is mostly the paintings.
Yes.
I do commissions, but I only do people I like. I won't.
Well.
Do,
and I will tell
I'll
you.
I'll turn down Dave Matthews and Pink Floyd till the fucking cows come home. I don't,
so, Ed actually did a commission for me of my friend Kate Howard, which I gave her as a gift for her record release. And I think it was the best
Let's
gift
all touch
I've ever
her hair,
given.
Fuck it.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, if you didn't quite understand this, Ed paints these paintings. And there's quite a little underground of art collectors.
There is. I know.
Yeah.
No one's more surprised by this than me, really.
Yeah.
It's like a part-time job that I like.
Yeah.
You know? I don't.
And it's the coolest band merch ever. So.
No, thanks.
Yeah. So he is going to meet us over there. All of the things
I'm
that he
not.
Just talked about that he does, you notice he did not give me the numbers that I was looking for, but it all costs money. I'm telling you, it all costs money, and probably more than you think it costs for him to do these things and for him to tour the country. If you leave with $1,000 in your Venmo tonight, how many miles will that get you, do you think?
I don't know, but all this talk about money, maybe my dad was Jewish, so I can tell this joke. Ready? I got to show you. Wait, you got to see this. This is funny. Come here for one second. It's the Jewish tailor. What a fit.
Okay. I've harped on y'all enough about money.
That was really funny. Fuck you.
It was funny. Yeah, and now I'm like all itchy and my clothes fit weird. Thanks, Ed.
You're welcome.
That's what we want from an Ed Hamill show. So
that'd be great. Testimonials. Oh, yeah. He moved me. It was poignant. What did you think? I'm all itchy and my clothes fit weird.
Yeah.
I'm in, man. I'm going to go see him. Fuck it.
I have a feeling that's going to be on the Instagram. Thank you for indulging me being ridiculous up here. I want to tell you a couple more things. So again, it's Direct Support House Concerts. There are some sheets around here that tell you who's coming up next. If you're so inclined to come out to another show, Kelly Green is my next one on August 13th, Friday the 13th next week. She is of Madam Radar. So Austinites have heard of her. I also have coming up Robin Mordecai, Donovan Keith, Anna Larson, and Aaron Ivey. We're going to keep doing this as long as we can. You know, if the pandemic gets to a point where we can't, then we'll just pause. But for now, you know, we're just going to keep powering through. So thank you for being here. Thank you for listening well. Thank you for supporting independent music.
Thanks very much for coming. I love Austin. Again, yeah. Thanks.
We all appreciate you very much. Thank you. And feel free to stick around and visit with each other and use the bathroom one at a time for as long as it takes. Thank you.